that have been sent. There's much different in the word come than the word go. Everybody have a call because God made a universal call for all the world, but everybody don't have the word go. You're not sent until you're qualified, sanctified, justified, and glorified. It's a pity to have such a wonderful program as this. And then right on the very end, right. I don't know if I'm going to speak far, if I'm supposed to speak for the women or to the women. But I can certainly say that they have rendered us a wonderful program. And we have enjoyed all our visits and everything that was said and done in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. I don't think that the words would allow me to, I don't have words to tell just my feeling towards these women tonight, and especially these young people. And I was just telling Deacon Durham, 10 years from now, the Pentecostal church is going to really have some good wives and some good husbands when our sons and daughters grow up. I guess the Lord is using the old timers to make the young ones. Usually there's so much different things in old timers until you have to kill them to get it out. And by the time you get them all ready to put something in him, he's too old and then he's dead. Young people don't have anything in them but foolishness. And when you get foolishness out, different doctrine and religious ideas and self-righteousness, you don't have to worry about it. I guess this is why the Catholic people reach for the children. And I guess that's why they're such a great church. I heard the announcement concerning this program, and it said everybody should dress up real nice. And looks like everybody's taking advantage of that. I've seen more different kinds of dresses tonight than I've seen in some time. What did y'all been keeping them? Or did you just get them a day? I used to haul logs. And I had a truck, or some trucks rather, that had trailers. And I seen some dresses tonight that remind me of my truck and trailer. Yeah, I know it's on this program, but that's a lecture. And I think you have to be a doctor of divinity to be a good lecturer. And I don't have any kind of degree. I didn't never care, don't care too much for D.D. Theologians call that Dr. Divinity, D.D. And I guess the Lord called it D.D.'s in the book of Isaiah was dumb dog. The Lord said in the book of Isaiah, the watchmen are blind, they are all ignorant, they are dumb dogs. So D.D. could be dumb dogs, right? Now, lots of them that have degrees, they are. And they never get too much about the LLDs. Because I learned that was a doctor of the law. And I don't care anything about the PhD. But there's one degree that I have. And I earned that. I didn't think he'd get it. And that's the BA. And the BA degrees is what everybody should have, and that's born again.
Amen.
This passage reads that likewise ye wives be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they may also be without the word, be warned by the conversation of the wife. The thing that we're trying to do in this Pentecostal Church of God is to make husbands and wives that we can have better homes. And if we have better husbands and wives and better homes, then we have a better church. I don't think that you can live anything in church if you don't live at home. I don't care about a whole lot of Holy Ghost at that. Talking every kind of song at church and talking the devil's song at the house. I think that a good church starts off in a good home. And the church, some people say, I don't care if I hear certain preachers preach because they get in your business. Preacher can't do a good job on you unless they get in your business. So then, seemingly, that the sermon tonight is based around good wives. We have a lot of wives in here, and we have a lot of prospective wives. We have a lot of women just hoping to be wives. We would have a lot of women that would like to be wives. Then we have a lot of women, perhaps like a woman that asked me to pray for her to get her husband in some of my revivals in Florida. She walked up to me and she said, Reverend Peterson, I have very much respect for your ministry and I have faith in your prayers. And I'd like if you pray for me to get me a wife, a husband. I said, all right, I'll be glad to. Maybe the Lord will grant such petition. And she said, now, wait a minute before you start praying. You better let me explain the kind of husband I want. She said, he's got to be so high, and he's got to weigh so much. He's got to be a certain color. He's got to be a certain age. She said, he's got to be so far in school, and she went on to give all his qualifications. And she said, well, wait. Then he's got to do what I say. I said, now you wait. You don't want a husband. What you want is a television. Something you can turn on and off. I said, because if you get a husband, he's going to turn you on. It's pitiful, let me run your broker. I think that a prayer's got to be right before it'll be acceptable unto God. A lot of things we pray over is vain prayer. God won't ask anything against his written word. Although he have give his people certain things that was against them to prove them, to show himself as being the wise. But certain prayers, when it comes to our natural affair and our way of living and our customs, they're going to have to be in line with God's word.
Amen.
Now, God expects a wife, and that's the reason I can preach this subject, because we have good wives here. God expects a wife to be in reverence to her husband. And what our printer, our typist here, if you notice, he's the one done this printing, and her name is supposed to be on this bill someplace, I guess. Maybe she didn't put it on here, but Sister Lurie. And I guess she was printing, was it a bill or a Bible school book or something? Or maybe in the newspaper. And she had in there about, yes, in the newspaper they were printing. The sermon, the lesson that I taught in the bishop's council in Tampa, Florida. And she went on to say the apostles taught about spots and wrinkles. And she explained the wrinkles and the spots. And she told, he told her wives how to be subject to their husbands and their husbands to their wives. Dr. Wayman, don't you quit that. conduct and all the way around. The Bible did not say that a husband be subject to, and I quote, she perhaps would love for it to be like that, but that the Bible did not say that a husband be subject to the wife. It said a husband loved the wife, and the wife subject to the husband. But she said the wife subject to their husband and the husband to their wife. So the thing that moves God into behalf of good women is to have a spirit that coincides with the written word. And if you notice in our lesson tonight, it said that the ungodly women would be warned. Even them that don't believe in the word, a good wife could win them by her conversation coupled with fear. There's a whole lot of people that instead of being warned, they're turning from God by disobedient and rebellious and wives. We want to someday give these young women away to some Holy Ghost men, and we want to feel that we are doing them a favor and not just getting rid of something. And I think that the Word of God, it will take the Word of God to make Sarah. Because this passage is going to say that they are the daughters of Sarah. But it says, as long as you do well. A good wife will reverence her husband. She will obey him. Not just because she's afraid of him, but she will obey him because she loves him. And I guess one of the most chief reasons for God to want a woman to be so subject is because she was the first thing that brought sin in the world. Man was not deceived, but the woman was deceived. So the Lord wants man to take his rightful place and get back and lead, because the head of every woman is the man. Of course, we don't like to hear too much of that kind of doctrine. When we get to that kind of doctrine, we say, who said that? Usually it says Paul said it, or Peter said it. But let us change that and say God said it. The Lord doesn't want Jezebel. Women that bring in strange doctrines and teach doctrines of Baal and sin, turn God's people from God unto idol worship. God does not want his men to marry Delilah, which is the sweetheart of Samson. Incidentally, I like to mention this, bring this passage of scripture to your mind. It says, so many people reading the book of Jeremiah where it says, the Lord has created a new thing in her, and the woman shall compass the man. And they go on to say that a woman can be anything in a church that a man can be, because the Bible says the woman shall compass the man. But if you notice the misunderstanding of the word compass don't mean exceed. The word compass means the same thing that the woman done for Samson. Encircling. Bringing down. The same thing that Jezebel done to Ahab. She compassed him. She subdued him. She brought him to nothing. And if in order for women to compass a man, the Lord called them backsliding daughters. You can check that in the book of Jeremiah. So you don't want to be one of the kind that compass the man. That's offense. For this cause, the Bible speaks very definitely against women being heads. It's not the head of every man a woman, but it's the head of every woman a man. I don't walk on my head. I walk on my feet. And my head tells my feet and my hand. So it is with the church. Is a wife to God. Even as God wants you to be wise to your husband. And he wants you to be real wise, that you can be real saints. Because you're part of the church, which is a collective body of members. And you are the light of the world. And all the unsaved women going to do like you do. Not like you say, but like you do. Oftentimes we have women tell me, say, pray for my husband that he might get saved. And if you go around that home and see the way she treats that husband, you can hear that husband secretly saying, Ellen, instead of praying for me to get saved, wreck on my wife. Sometimes he can't get saved because he attended by the wife. I don't know if I'm supposed to talk to you or... If you notice in my lesson in the third chapter of 1 Peter, it tells you how to dress. It did not say those three things. It said braid of fat. And what he was actually doing, he was saying of ornament, of gold and of pearl. In this day, the women would do like the Jezebels do today. They had hair on them, and they would wrap this gold in their hair. That was outward adornment. And somebody got up a doctor and said the women don't supposed to straighten the hair. That would be all right for the people that wrote this Bible. Because the people that wrote this Bible, see, this Bible was written from Jerusalem, from the Jews, looking on the outside wall from the children of Israel. And if you notice, the Jews don't need a saving call. They'd have to tell them to straighten the hair. Because it was already strange. But I don't know just what happened when the gospel got to Africa. I'm sure that the African brothers and sisters, or that the African sisters wanted to be like their Jewish sisters. And they looked on their Jewish sisters and wanted to be so much like them. Walk like them, talk like them, act like them. And they looked at them heads and said, that's going to do. That long, beautiful black hair and blonde swaying down the back and around the shoulders and covering the face. And look in the scripture and say, for a woman to have long hair is glory to her. It didn't say her hair was a glory. It said for her to have long hair is glory to her. Yeah. Then the poor African sisters couldn't produce any long hair because it would get too curly. And they think it's part of the world to straighten out the curve. Let it go for God straight. You can never appreciate the gospel until you find out who you is. You can't turn God acting like somebody that you are not. Anybody trying to act like somebody they are not, that's what I call hypocrite. The word hypocrite means a person pretending to be a thing in which they are not. So then, women, if you notice, you don't find our women with gold, of course, you don't have to worry about them flashing gold in their hair. They don't have it. Get on them and braid it and pat it in the hair. That's outward adornment. But we kind of believe that we should clean the outside. That the inside may be clean also. I don't care too much about God all on the inside and not on the outside. Jesus did not say he just wants a heart. God didn't have to make a big 200-pound like me just to get a heart. But he made a heart. A spirit, soul, and a body. I guess the spirit for the guide of man's mind, the soul for his private conversation with God, and the body for the container of the truth, which is the temple of the living God. So you see, Jesus said, clean the inside. But he didn't stop preaching there. He preached a little longer so that outside may be clean also. I don't go much for rings and decorations. We don't go any for earrings. Because earrings lose us. If you notice what Israel lost their connection with their big God, their saving God. Moses stayed up in the mountain too long. Nailing said, I bring me, you little God. What is that, your earring? And I'll make you a God. And taking the earrings, which is the little God, and molded them and made them a golden chain. But when it comes to properly dressing, I think we should have.
If a $20 suit changed your attitude, I think you should try a $10 suit. Well, if a $1,000 suit don't change your love for your brother and change your everyday conversation, I think you should buy what you can. Come on here. I'm close. It's over to the left. When I think on rocks, some women say, I'll do what I want. What at all? You can't do what you want. Well, you see, you're born with a price. And you were not redeemed. That word redeemed, I mean bought back. And you wasn't redeemed with corruptible things as Syrian gold. But with the precious blood of Jesus. And you're born with a precious price. So that you cannot do the things you want to do. Oh, no man don't want his wife looking at anybody. Man that don't care who his wife loves or share her affection with is a man that don't love his wife. Isn't it so? Lord, so a man's wife, if he and his wife go walking down the street, and she go gazing after other men too much, he don't have to be funny and jealous. But that suffering must keep coming to his mind. What's wrong with her? When she walking and messing and showing off before the men, he may not say that, he may not want to be a fool, but when he get home, he said, well, what was wrong with you then? Oh, well, who are you trying to tell? I'm trying to show you God and his wife. She said, just move eyeballing. Make sure. Don't worry, he might have put them on the street. Because some of them won't say nothing. They'll do something. So the Lord told his people, watch your eyes. Don't be a lover of others in the world of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. So you can't look in too many places. God said to get your attention. You can't be lustful at the things you want. You got to have the things your husband wants you to have. Maybe this is kind of against the grain. Well, we check the Bible, then you will find holy women knew the thing that God was falling in love with, and that was a meek and a quiet spirit. That's why I say when the women are being taught, let them learn in silence. It didn't say for a woman to teach. They said when she's being taught, woman can't teach because she has to use of authorities over the man. The woman forbids the use of authorities over the man. That's why women can't be bishops, because bishops have to have a wife, and women don't usually have wives. That's the reason women can't be deacons. Deacons have to have a wife. And women don't usually. Sometimes they get the wife, but not usually. That's what the Bible says. So the Lord had him, but the Lord perhaps lived a miserable, lonely life for a long time. And without a wife. And one day he decided to get him a wife and call out one man to start his family. Call him Father Abraham. And Abraham gave a son to Isaac. And Isaac, Jacob. And Jacob, the 12th son. And they lived in Canaan, which was the promised land for some years. And God wanted to give them that land and bring them out of a land of misery and doubt. And he let the corn run out in that land and sent plenty of corn in Egypt. And they were compelled to go down to Egypt, which was the type of the world, and serve under Pharaoh, a mean, worldly king, which was the type of the devil. And after staying there for a long time, engagement day drew near. And the Lord sent a man by the name of Moses to gather his wife. If you notice, when Jesus said, "You adulterous generation," he wasn't speaking of a man going with a woman. It wasn't an individual affair, but it was a nation, a national affair. It simply means that any time you let other gods come into you and adopt the other spirits and let them come in your service, you have committed adultery on your husband, which is God. So then he separated them from their enemy by Red Sea. Called out on the other side, and the women got together and put on something, some kind of everything.
But I brought
got the tambourines and start
there. This has been the Pentecostal hour.
I don't know if they had it in the office there.
But the Pentecostal Church of God at 1339 Clay Street, Detroit, the 11 Mission. Now you may send your card, letter, Bible questions, and two-year offerings to Elder W.J. Peterson at 1339 Clay Street.